For now, we're going to introduce the YouTube sensation. For a few minutes, they're going to join us. Nicole and Scotty from Uncharted Waters. And then at 8 o'clock, Tom Mesereau. Good evening, Nicole and Scotty. How are you?
Hi, Jordan. How are you? Nice to talk to you again.
Yes, it's nice to talk to you indeed. And you did Unbreakable, and you did a great job. And first and foremost, for the audience that don't know, you actually performed with Lisa Marie Presley, Michael Jackson's former wife. Is that true?
Yes, back in 2018, Lisa found us on YouTube and invited us to perform with her twice.
Wow, okay. And Scotty, what was your thoughts of that?
It was an amazing experience.
Okay, we just have Nicole now.
Oh, look, it's Scotty right here.
Okay.
Absolutely.
And what is your YouTube channel?
Our YouTube channel is The Music in Me 777, and you can just find us on any social media outlet by typing in Nicole and Scotty, and our official web page should come up when you Google our names as well.
And Scotty, you have played some awesome guitar work, right? For Michael Jackson, Scotty. Tell us about that.
Oh, I love to cover Michael. He's a genius. His music is truly remarkable.
Right, right. And what are the songs that you did by his guitar, with your guitar?
I did Dirty Diana, Beat It, Give In To Me, Do You Know Where Your Children Are?
Oh, wow. Those all sound great, but in my opinion, all the great songs are with Michael Jackson. And, of course, you guys performed, which is now available on YouTube, Unbreakable, which is courtesy of the Michael Jackson album Invincible, which came out in 2001. How was that, doing that song?
Oh, it was great. What Scotty did to make what sounds like a backing track is he has a guitar pedal that's called a looper. And what he does is he'll drum on his guitar and it'll record a beat, and then he'll do a bass line and then he'll strum over it. So it sounds like there's more than one guitar playing and it's actually all Scotty. So it's fun to layer those, and he came up with that arrangement last night and we recorded it, and it was a great, great time. It was an energetic song to record. Invincible is our favorite album that Michael ever released.
It's a great album. Just want to remind everybody that in about 5 minutes, Tom Mesereau will be joining us. And, Scotty, let me go back to you. Who is your favorite? Who is your three favorite artists?
Three favorite artists of all time?
Of all time.
Definitely Michael, Lisa Marie Presley, and right now, John Mayer.
What was the last one?
John Mayer.
John Mayer, interesting. Nicole, let me go to you on that question. Give me your top three artists.
Oh, gosh, that's so hard. Definitely Lisa Marie Presley. I've loved her since I was 6 years old. Michael would have to be up in the top three as well, because we grew up with his music since we were very little. And we even remember watching him be announced as innocent. I think I was like 7 years old or eight at the time. And then,
You guys had to be really young.
Yes?
You guys definitely had to be really young.
Yeah, we were, for sure. Yeah. And then, right now I think my next favorite artist would have to be Taylor Swift.
People have mixed reactions. They either love her or they hate her. Sort of like the Justin Bieber sensation, which, in my opinion, is over. Justin Bieber, it doesn't seem like, if you go and you look at the numbers, They are not consistent. They are not what they once were. Once upon a time, now Justin Bieber was the hottest thing since sliced bread.
Right.
Not anymore. All his problems got in the way. So,
Well, I mean, that happens. It depends on how you handle your fame. But, you know, I've heard very good things about him. And you know, I never like to believe things that are said in tabloids. Or, you know, I prefer to hear it directly from the artists themselves. And we respect everybody in the industry. But I've heard
I respect the Mr. Bieber. I just think we know what he admitted to, which
right.
is drinking and taking pills and just doing some bad things. And I understand he was young, but listen, the bottom line, he was no Michael Jackson, and he is no Michael Jackson. There could only be one Michael Jackson, and
absolutely.
That's that, as far as I'm concerned. So, again, why don't you mention how they could get a hold of your music?
Yeah, for sure. Scotty and I released our debut album last year in August, and it's titled Nicole and Scotty Uncharted Waters, and you can purchase it on iTunes, Amazon, and CD Baby. Just by typing in Nicole and Scotty will come up. And I believe the cheapest place to get it right now would be iTunes. Just the digital download of each song is 99 cents.
Okay, and I thank you so much for joining us. We're going to be joined with Mr. Tom Mesereau. So for Nicole and Scotty, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having us. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, good night. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time you could call in with your questions. 10 years ago, Michael Jackson was acquitted on 10 felony counts and 4 less included. The man that helped and was the strategist behind the whole acquittal of Michael Jackson joins us today on a very special day. It is with great pleasure to introduce a very special person. Ladies and gentlemen, he is a defense attorney out of Los Angeles. He defended Michael Jackson from the months of February to June. He had to make several sacrifices to get the win. And it is with great pleasure that we introduce. He was honored a couple months back at the Cleveland Club, and now he is being honored today for what he did 10 short years ago, it feels like. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the one, the only defense attorney, Tom Mesereau. Good evening, Tom, and welcome back to King Jordan Radio.
Hi, Jordan. Thank you so much for having me. I'm very honored and privileged to be on your show on a very, very memorable and special day. Thank you.
Absolutely. I want to play this clip, and then I want to get your take on the other side.
Superior Court of the State of California for the County of Santa Barbara, Santa Maria Division. The people of the State of California, plaintiff versus Michael Joe Jackson, defendant. Case number 1133603. Count one, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of conspiracy as charged in count one of the indictment. Dated June 13th, 2005. Four person, number 80. Count two, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count two of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, four person number 80. Count three, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count three of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, four person number 80. Count four, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count four of the indictment, dated June 10th, 2005, for person number 80. Count 5, verdict. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count 5 of the indictment, dated June 10th, 2005, for person number 80. Count 6, verdict. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of attempting to commit a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count 6 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80.
There are only
count
the
7, verdict.
Now remaining
we, the jury, in the above entitled
alcohol.
Case,
did
find the defendant not guilty of administering an intoxicating agent to assist in the commission of a felony as charged in count 7 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 7, verdict, lesser offense. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of providing alcoholic beverages to persons under the age of 21, a lesser included offense of that charge in count 7 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 8, verdict. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of administering an intoxicating agent to assist in the commission of a felony as charged in count 8 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 8, verdict, lesser offense. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of providing alcoholic beverages to persons under the age of 21, a lesser included offense that charged in count 8 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 9, verdict. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of administering an intoxicating agent to assist in the commission of a felony as charged in count 9 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80. Count 9, verdict, lesser offense. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of providing alcoholic beverages to persons under the age of 21, a lesser included offense of that charge in count 9 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80. Count 10, verdict. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of administering an intoxicating agent to assist in the commission of a felony as charged in count 10 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80. Count 10, verdict, lesser offense. We, the jury, in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of providing alcoholic beverages to persons under the age of 21, a lesser included offense of that charge in count 10 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80.
Okay, before I go to Tom for his reaction, you can call into the radio show at 347-857-2950. Now, Tom, listening to that, what does that bring back?
Well, I had goosebumps listening to this. Anytime I do listen to these verdicts, I get goosebumps. I think my heart rate increases. I think my blood pressure increases, and I just am reminded what a very, very tense, special, but, you know, I don't know how to explain it. It's a day, I woke up that day knowing something special was going to happen. Deep down inside, I was confident, but I also knew that everything we had worked for could either prove successful or be a disaster. And I just knew when I woke up something special was going to happen. You never know what a jury will do. You don't know those people. They're individuals that you've learned a little bit about, but not much. You never know what their interaction in the jury room will be like, what the chemistry among them will be like, who will dominate, who will voice their opinions and maybe not stand up for them and maybe be more willing to change their opinions than others. It's a mystery. And when you've got a life in your hands, like for anybody, I mean, everybody's life is precious. Everyone's freedom is precious. And when you have a life in your hands, it's always a major event. When you've got Michael Jackson's life in your hands and everyone around the world has stopped what they're doing to see whether you've accomplished what you set out to accomplish or whether you're going to spend the rest of your life as the man that sent him to prison, it puts a little added pressure on you. But it was a very special day. I'll never forget it. One of the greatest days of my life. And when I think about it, I'm just grateful to God and grateful to many people who stood for us and stood behind us. But I'm also a little bit sad because it put Michael Jackson through a horrific experience, and I can't help but remember the stress and the strain and the terror and the fear that he experienced. And looking back now, I'm not so sure if he ever totally recovered from it. I think his reputation and his legacy were preserved, but I think his spirit in some ways was broken. And as great a day as it was for me, and it was one of the greatest days of my life, really, I always have to stop and remember that that this great day in my life occurred because a tremendous injustice was done to a wonderful human being who was not really prepared or built to be put through this kind of a dreadful experience. And as happy as I am that I was his lead counsel, as honored as I am to have succeeded in preserving his freedom, I can't help but remember that he was terribly hurt by this. So it was a day of extremes, extreme exhilaration, extreme excitement. It was just one of the greatest days of my life, but I also know that it happened because a very innocent and very special human being was put through a horrible, torturous experience that he shouldn't have been part of. So that's my answer to your question, Jordan. It was a great day for justice, a great day for freedom, but remember always that a soul was tortured who should not have been put through that.
I totally agree, and I see a lot of people on hold. We will get to you. I just want to play some clips from 10 years ago, all courtesy of the great Luna Joe, 67. Now, this goes back to February 23rd, 2005, when they were talking about, I think, jury selected.
Big development in the Michael Jackson case. A jury has been chosen in this case. Apparently a jury of 4 men and 8 women were selected for pop star Michael Jackson's trial on charges that he molested 13-year-old boy at his Neverland Valley Ranch. Let's go to MSNBC's Jennifer London with more details on this. This is way ahead of schedule, Jennifer.
Lisa, it certainly is ahead of schedule, especially considering that we had 2 weeks of jury selection delays. This is only the second day of jury selection this week, and as you mentioned, a jury has been sworn in for Michael Jackson's child molestation trial. 8 women and 4 men have been selected to serve on this jury. They will decide whether or not they think the pop star is guilty of child molestation. They are now in the process of looking to see 8 alternates. Those will be folks that will be called in to serve on the jury should the original 12, should one person of the original 12 be excused for any reason during the course of this trial. As you mentioned, this process going much quicker than anyone had anticipated. Last week, jury selection was delayed because Michael Jackson was suffering from flu-like symptoms. The week before, jury selection was delayed because lead defense attorney Thomas Mesereau's sister passed away. So everyone gathered here at the courthouse in Santa Maria this week thinking, you know, we're really just getting into this process. This could be another 2-3 weeks maybe, so this certainly coming as a surprise. But I can tell you yesterday the jury selection process moved very quickly, both the defense and the prosecution excusing a number of witnesses, and again today they have sworn in a jury for Michael Jackson's child molestation trial.
And Jennifer, it seems like Judge Melville deserves some credit here, meaning that he only allowed 10 or so minutes for each questioning of the jurors, the potential jurors. Is this, in terms of the schedule, we heard that there could be weeks of juror selection going on, but now it's just the alternates. How long do you think that will take?
It's to select the alternates? Well, we really don't know, and I hesitate to make any guesses, if you will, because we simply didn't see this coming. Again, everyone thought jury selection would take much longer, especially when you consider the delay. So we really don't know what to expect with regard to seating the alternates. But I can tell you, Judge Melville running a very tight ship, he did only allow each side 10 minutes to question. He made sure that he kept that time schedule on track. He also told the prospective jurors yesterday that he was very sensitive to their time. He apologized for the delays. So you really get the sense that he wants to keep this thing on schedule.
All right, MSNBC's Jennifer London. Jennifer, thanks. Of course, we'll be keeping an eye out on other developments. But the big headline here, a jury of 4 men and 8 women selected in the Michael Jackson trial. This is way ahead of schedule. Prosecutors and lawyers are now beginning the selection process for the 8 alternates on that jury.
All right, first of all, once you did pick the jury, did you feel comfortable with it, A, and B, what did you think of their reporting? Was it on the money? Was it sort of on the money? Or what do you think?
Well, I'm someone with very strong intuitions and very strong feelings about individual jurors. You know, I'm not always correct, but I've been correct a lot in my career. And I think intuition and instinct are more important than intellect when it comes to deciding within the confines of, you know, of jury selection procedures, who you should accept. And, you know, I went against the advice of many people in how I handled the jury. First of all, there was a lot of criticism of me for not trying to move the trial out of Santa Maria. And as I've said many times before, I went up alone to Santa Maria and would hang out in some restaurants and bars and talk to people on the street a little bit, not be very overt and very aggressive in the way I did it. I would go into bars, I would just mind my own business, have a glass of wine. I'd be sitting in my jeans and black leather jacket, you know, and somebody invariably would come up and they would ask me, are you Michael Jackson's lawyer? And I would say, yes, you know, and they'd say, what are you doing up here? I said, well, I'm just getting acclimated to the community, getting used to the place where I'm going to live for probably, at that time, we thought it might be 8 months, the trial. And I would chat casually with people, and I wanted to know what they thought of Michael Jackson, and I got a very strong feeling that people in the community were not hostile to Michael Jackson. That they were very hostile to this kind of charge, which is child molestation, which to me is a worse charge than murder, but that they were very independent-minded people, and they would keep an open mind. And I'd ask them about Tom Snedden and the DA's office, and the feeling I got was they were not just going to roll over for the DA's office. They were just not going to kowtow to what they want. And I got the feeling we could probably, you know, get a fair jury up here. Remember, this is where Michael Jackson lived and where he employed about 100 people. And, you know, he was their celebrity. He could have lived anywhere in the world, and he chose their community. So I got the distinct impression that this would be as good a place to try the case and pick a jury as any other place. And if we made a motion to change venue and if it was granted, it might go north to Bakersfield, which was just as conservative as Santa Maria, but where he didn't live and didn't have a presence, or it could go south to Ventura County, just as conservative. But again, he didn't live there. He didn't employ people. They didn't see him in town once in a while. They didn't bring tours to his home in their counties. So I said, I want to stay right here. And I was, you know, hit with all this criticism by some attorneys who were trying to stab me in the back, by some legal analysts on TV who wanted me to lose. And remember, a lot of the media was against me because they didn't want me in the case. They wanted prior counsel who they thought would give them inside information, who they thought would do their bidding a lot more than I was willing to do. That was my impression, at least. And I remember when I got in the case, Geraldo Rivera for a week was attacking me every night on his show. He wanted Garagos and Ben Braffin to be back in the case because I think he thought they would cooperate with him more than I would. The media knew that I was not going to do their bidding. I was not their puppet. I was not their stooge, and I wasn't looking for a TV show. So they wanted what was right for their business, and it was big business. So all these efforts were made to undermine me. Now, I could have done something else that I didn't do. I could have requested under the rules that some potential jurors from South Santa Barbara County near the city of Santa Barbara be shipped up. And the general feeling was that in the South County, the general feeling was that jurors were more liberal, because that's where you had all the wealthy patrons of the arts, the wealthy people who supported the library and the creative arts in Santa Barbara. That's where you had the University of California at Santa Barbara. And I didn't want to do that either. And I was criticized for that. I remember, Jordan, your favorite reporter, Diane Diamond, was criticizing me for not...
My favorite reporter.
I'm just kidding. I remember she was criticizing me for not requesting that jurors from South County be shipped up to North County where Santa Maria was. And I had a very strong reason for not doing that. I had done some research before I moved up there to pick a jury, and I discovered that there was a very strong difference of political opinion between the north part of the county where the trial was taking place and the south part of the county where the so-called liberals live. And people in the north were largely blue-collar, very conservative. People in the south, less conservative, less blue-collar, many of them very affluent. But people in the north, where Santa Maria was, took great pride in their community. And I felt that if I asked that jurors from South County be shipped up, that would be assigned to the jurors from the Santa Maria community that I didn't have confidence in them. And I did have confidence in them. Well, I didn't do that. So geniuses like Diane Diamond were criticizing me for not making that decision. I also discovered that some bills have been introduced in the California state legislature to have the North secede from the South. In other words, they felt they were different people. They felt that they were independent people and didn't need the South County with all of its wealthy celebrities and patrons of the arts. And again, I did not want to offend the community. I wanted to show the community I had faith in it, that it would be fair and honest and honorable in the way it, you know, way it conducted this trial. And I just had a belief that these people are independent-minded. There was a libertarian streak where the general feeling was we're very conservative, we're very pro-law and order, but government don't go too deeply into our lives because we're good people. We don't like government digging too deeply into our lives. So I put all this together, my personal conversations and experience, my research, my perception, my intuition, and I said, you know, we're staying here, and we're going to get a fair trial. And then, you know, I had some research done by a jury consultant who felt that women were not going to be good for us in general, that mothers were going to be disasters for us. And I looked at her one day and I said, you know, I appreciate the research, but I want women and I want mothers. And I had my own personal reasons for doing that. You know, Michael was a very eccentric, creative genius.
Sure.
Who dressed differently than other people, whose creative instincts and intelligence and lifestyle was different than many people. And I also knew that on the prosecution side, you had these white heterosexual men attacking Michael's sexuality in many different ways. They were trying to suggest that he was attracted to little boys for sex. They were trying to suggest he was gay in some of their questions. They were trying to suggest he was asexual in some of their other questions. They were hoping there would be prejudice on the jury against him when they made these kinds of remarks. I remember Zonin got very desperate in some of his cross examination and, you know, suggested he was asexual, suggested all kinds of things. Snedden and Zonin and Auchincloss, the prosecutors, were, you know, repeating this mantra that he sleeps with little boys, you know, that I'm sure some jury consultant gave that mantra to them to repeat. And it was nasty business. And I wanted jurors who I thought would be less judgmental of Michael, would be open-minded. In general, I have found that women are much less judgmental about men who are being perceived as different or eccentric or whose sexuality is being attacked than heterosexual men. Men tend to be much more judgmental and to have much more insecurity about their sexuality. So I followed my instincts, and I wanted women on this jury. We got a majority of women. and we had some very intelligent jurors. I wanted intelligent jurors who I thought would see through the prosecution's antics. We had a math teacher with a master's degree in mathematics. We had a former high school principal with a master's degree in counseling. We had a civil engineer. We had a woman who ran the local social services agency. We had people with military training. And I just followed my instincts more than listening to anyone else, because most people you listen to either have their blinders on because of the media, or they had a different agenda. And as I recall, when I accepted this jury and I left a lot of my challenges on the table, because I had the right to remove more jurors than I did. And one of the reasons it went so slowly was that I thought the prosecution was sort of playing a game. This is the game I thought they were playing. It was pure instinct on my part. I looked at these three white male prosecutors with little experience in the African American community, and I said to myself, they think that I'm desperate to get a black person on the jury to hang this jury, because in their minds, most black people were for Michael Jackson. And you know, a black woman appeared on the panel. They removed her. I made a constitutional objection. It was overruled. A second black woman appeared on the panel. They removed her. I made another constitutional objection at sidebar, and the judge overruled my objection. And then there was a young black man in the alternate ranks who theoretically and mathematically could have made his way to the panel. And I felt the prosecutors thought that I would use every challenge I had to try and get him on the jury, because they felt that they couldn't lose this case and that Mesereau just wants an African-American juror to hang the jury. And that wasn't true at all. You know, my whole approach was Michael Jackson brings all races together. He brings all religions together. He brings all ethnic groups together. He doesn't divide people. He unites people. And I didn't think I needed someone just because they were black or African-American to win this case. So the prosecutors kept accepting the panel, thinking I'm going to exhaust all my challenges, and then they were going to just run the table on me and use all theirs. And I accepted the panel, and I saw their jaws dropped. I think they were in shock. I was under pressure. You know, Michael and his family were hoping there'd be some African-American representation on the jury. But I told them, I said, trust me, I really feel good about what I'm doing. And you're bringing back old thoughts about the tension of that period, the difficulty of the period. You know, my only sibling, my sister, who was a year and a half younger than me, succumbed to cancer in the middle of jury selection. It was very difficult. I had to run back. I was her only sibling. My father had passed away years ago. My mother was not well, and I had to take care of her funeral and all the rest. Fortunately, I had some help, and you know, it was a rough time, but we got the job done. But you're bringing back old feelings from 10 years ago, actually longer than 10 years ago, and you know everybody was criticizing everything I did for various reasons. They were trying to undermine me with the family. Well, a lot of people were. You had lawyers who were jealous and envious, and lawyers who I had replaced who wanted to get back in. You had jealous people trying to undermine every decision I made. You know, I was living in a fishbowl. But fortunately, we came through, and I'm so proud to have been Michael Jackson's lead criminal defense lawyer. It was a high point of my career, but again, there's a little bit of sadness there because he should not have been put through this horrendous experience.
It definitely is a mixed situation. Let's go out to the callers. Let me go in the order that I see them in. Tom, are you with me?
I'm with you. I hear everything.
Okay. So we're definitely might be having some phone troubles. Let's try 973. Let me let you in. It is your turn, and you are on live, 973.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, can you please state your name and where you're calling from?
Hi, my name is Teresa Stevens. I'm calling from Irvington, New Jersey.
Hi, good evening.
Hi,
how are you doing?
Hi, Mr. Mesereau.
Hi.
Hi, you may recognize my name when you go into your office when Michelle and Jane sent you a thank you letter from all the fans.
Oh, my that's nice. Thank you.
Well, I really don't have a question. I just want to thank you, you know, for defending our Michael. We can't thank you enough, and God bless you.
Well, thank you very much. You're very kind. I really appreciate it. Please give my best to Michelle Lane.
I sure will. Have a good day.
You too.
Thanks for the call. Absolutely. Let's try Long Island again. 631, please state your name and where you're calling from. You're live with Tom Mesereau.
Hi, my name is Steve.
631, it's your turn. Yes?
Hi, my name is Steve. I'm feeling a little sick, so I don't know if you can hear me clearly, but hi, Tom.
Hi, how you doing? Sorry
I'm
you're not
good.
Feeling well.
Thanks. I'm trying to get over it, but I couldn't miss the show, so.
Okay, thanks. What's your question or comment for Tom?
I was wondering about when, after the trial, when the mother got arrested, how long was she in jail, and do you know anything else about that case for fraud or something? Like, well,
I really don't know. I know that based on the evidence that was that we accumulated pre-trial, she was eventually prosecuted for welfare fraud. She ended up making a plea bargain of some kind. I don't think she did much jail time, but she certainly was convicted. It may have been eventually reduced to a misdemeanor and expunged, for all I know. I was not part of that, nor did I instigate that. As far as I was concerned, Michael was vindicated completely. 10 felony acquittals, 4 lesser-included misdemeanor acquittals, and I really felt our job had been done, and I wasn't part of that whole prosecution at all.
Oh, that's interesting. But I'm working on a book. I'm going to write a book, so because I want to look to change some of the laws and the age restrictions for certain things, like buying a home, you know, having a driver's license, you know, things like that, like reducing the age. So I'm actually wondering what Michael would think of that.
Well, Michael was someone who really loved humanity. He valued people. It hurt him to see anyone devalued because of their race, their age, their gender, their ethnicity, their religion. He saw the inherent value in human beings. And I suspect, based on what little you said, he would have liked what you were doing.
Thank you. That means a lot to me, actually. So I'll have to send you guys a copy of the book when I release it.
Thank you very much. I'd love to read it.
Okay, thank you
very
much.
Have a good
night.
Good luck.
Thank you for the call, and you think Michael would appreciate that, right, Tom?
Michael didn't like to see people devalued or frustrated in their efforts to improve themselves and to improve the world. So, again, I don't know a lot more about what she's wants to do, but generally speaking, based on what she said, I think he would like the idea of more freedom and more value to people because of their age.
Okay, Luna Joe is in the chat room, and she says she's very tired. She's in the Netherlands, time difference, of course. She says, can you please send my love to Tom, and thank you so much for everything you do. That's from Luna Joe.
Well, I'm very honored to receive that message from her, and I'm a great admirer of what she does, and please give her my best, and I hope to meet her one day.
Absolutely. Okay, let's go out to area code 330. Please state your name and where you're calling from. 330, you're on.
Hi, my name is Nelson. I'm calling from Canton, Ohio. Hi, Jordan.
Hi,
and
Nelson.
Hi, Mr. Mesereau.
Hi, Nelson.
I just want to say thank you so much for defending Michael. Thank you to you and Miss Susan Yu and your entire defense team. And I have one question for you.
Sure.
How do you cope or deal with defending Michael against people who have all these odd views about him and just they don't know him as a person. They just know by what the tabloids and the media what they say about him and everything. How do you deal with that with such a calm and yet defensive demeanor?
Well, I appreciate your perception of me, but there were some moments where I laid down in my bed at night and just asked God for guidance, because it was really a mess. There were so many powerful forces against us trying to undermine us, and there's so many things that went on that aren't really that well known. I mean, I was very, very cautious about witnesses, about meeting them, and allowed my investigators to do a lot of the interviews rather than me, because I was concerned that I was going to be set up by media interests, by business interests that were adverse to Michael. I was concerned that if I had any meeting with a witness, even with other witnesses there, that somebody would run to the media or run to the other side and say, Mesereau offered me this, or Mesereau tried to bribe me, or Mesereau tried to compromise or change what I was going to say, or tried to convince me to change things. I didn't know who was going to do what to get me out of that case. So I had that problem. As I said before, I had powerful media interests that knew I was not going to do their bidding and not going to cooperate with them, who wanted me out. They wanted lawyers who would help them with their shows, help them with their ratings, leak information to them. So they were against me. You had the DA's office that was being very, very aggressive and trying to intimidate the defense team. For example, when information appeared on some media outlets that was favorable to Michael, or that was anti the Arvizo family, they would make announcements that they were investigating where these leaks occurred, that they were going to prosecute people for obstruction of justice, including felony prosecutions, if they found out who was behind it. And I think it was an effort to intimidate defense lawyers, intimidate defense investigators. So you had that issue. You had the DA's office in Santa Barbara had hired their own public relations firm to spread information that was positive to they and their side. You had leaks from the grand jury that were, in my opinion, inexcusable. It was supposed to be a secret, confidential grand jury proceeding, yet efforts were being made to poison the media right away. All of this was going on, and as I said before, you had lawyers who were jealous and envious and bitter, trying to stab me in the back with the Jackson family, trying to get to Neverland to talk to Michael. There were attacks coming from all sides. I'd like to say I was some genius who knew how to handle this, but I wasn't at all. I was at times overwhelmed and just took one day at a time. We would get through each day, and I would prepare for the next day. I never overreacted to a good day or a bad day. If our cross-examination went very well, like it did many days, I never overreacted to it. You know, a case isn't over till it's over, and the dynamics and the chemistry in a courtroom can change in 1 second. So I asked God for guidance. I kept to myself. I was in bed at 7:30, latest 8 o'clock every night, up at 3 every day. The media couldn't find me in a hotel lobby. They couldn't find me in a bar or a restaurant. I knew they would try to put me in a compromising position if they could. Again, because I was not perceived as really their friend. And, you know, Berry Gordy, the founder of Motown, told me after the verdicts that I'd cost the worldwide media billions by acquitting him. So I don't know if I've answered your question completely, but these are some of the things that we had to cope with. And I'm very proud to say that I think I always did an honorable professional job as best I could to defend Michael Jackson and to preserve his freedom. I did the best I could, and fortunately, the fates were with us.
I have to say, I think you did an amazing job with the decisions and your strength, and I have to say thank you for that. You've done an amazing job, and thank you for continuing to defend him. And thank you for having me on, Jordan.
Thank you so much.
Thank
it was
you
very
for
nice
the call.
To meet you.
Absolutely. Okay, let's go out to, I believe this is New Jersey, 973. Please state your name and your and where you're calling from. You're live with King Jordan Radio, talking to Tom Mesereau. 973.
Hi, Jordan. Hi. Me against Teresa. I had just spoken to you guys. I don't know how I got on.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
But I do have a question now, if you don't mind, for Mr. Mesereau.
Sure. Go right ahead.
Hi, I was wondering, whatever happened to Brian Oxman? We don't hear anything about him any longer. Brian Oxman?
My answer is I have no idea. I'm not in communication with him. I don't know what he's doing.
Okay. All right. I guess that's it. Thank you. Thank you again.
Thank you.
That's all.
Okay. Let's go out to... let's try area code 917, which is New York. Please state your name and where you're calling from. 917, it's your turn.
Hi, my name is Lisa, and I wanted to talk to Tom.
Lisa, where are you calling from, dear?
Oh, I'm
calling
from...
Yes, but where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Forest Hills, New York.
Okay, the floor is yours.
Oh, hi, Tom. Mesereau, how are you today?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
Oh, I just finished reading Aphrodite's book, The Michael Jackson Conspiracy, and I read your foreword, and I also was just listening to what you've been saying about the trial, and I just can't believe it. How could all of this have gone on? It seems incredible.
Well, you know, I mean, I think, you know, it's hard to pinpoint where all of this started to develop, but I believe, it's just my opinion, that Attorney Howard Weitzman's settlement in 1993, which represented Michael Jackson, and when Michael Jackson paid a reported $20 million to Chandler, I think that set in motion a whole chain of events that resulted in the criminal trial in 2005, and I think that settlement just set in motion a series of events that changed his life completely for the worse.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I'm saying that's what I believe.
Well, I guess what a lot of people don't realize about that settlement is that, from what I understand, Michael Jackson did not want to make that settlement, that somehow he was convinced to do it by the attorney that you mentioned.
That's what he told me. And Randy Jackson, his brother, who I had lunch with in San Francisco a few months ago, told me that attorney Johnny Cochran wanted to try the case, but that Mr. Weitzman wanted to settle it. That's what he told me. I wasn't a witness to these events. I wasn't there. But I think it was the worst advice he ever got, and I think it just snowballed and led to this criminal trial. Remember, the criminal trial did not just involve the Arvizo claim. Under California law, the prosecutors tried to also prove that Jordy Chandler was molested, that Wade Robson was molested, that Fred Barnes was molested, that Macaulay Culkin was molested. There was the other fellow who also received a settlement. I forget his name, a so-called youth pastor in Santa Maria. But I think that settlement was the start of the demise of Michael Jackson. That's what I believe. It was, to me, the worst settlement in legal history. And
yes, I understand. It seems like it was a bad decision, and in the court of the public, this is why people still think he's guilty. And I think we have to explain to people that was not his idea. So
well, remember,
it's good that
the judge allowed the Weitzman settlement, evidence of it, to come into my trial. So I was just defending the Arvizo claims. I had to defend the allegations that Chandler and other people were molested. And the judge allowed into evidence the fact that Michael Jackson had settled, a claim with Jordy Chandler and a claim with Jason Franzi. So I had to battle all of these fronts in one trial. But
I understand what you were up against. I'm sorry, I'm interrupting you.
Mr. Weitzman says that he was against the settlement. I don't believe that for a second. I've said that repeatedly. His signature is on the document. It's on the Internet. And if you look at David Guest's wonderful documentary, Michael Jackson, The Life of an Icon, you'll see Weitzman right at the press conference to announce the settlement. So I don't believe, and you know, the information given to me was that he was the one that was the most, as far as the lawyers went, he was really pushing for that settlement. If you read Randall Solomon's book, Untouchable, he says words to that effect as well. So I just think it was the worst settlement ever. I think Michael never recovered from it. I think it set in motion a whole series of events that just resulted in this criminal trial where he was exonerated legally, but emotionally, I think, forever scarred. So
And you should, and Mr. Mesereau? Hello?
Yes.
I thought I got disconnected. That is what I always say about L.A. In terms of the law, L.A. is like a different planet because nowhere else in the country, I think, would it have been permissible to bring up something in another legal trial or conference. Is that correct? You can't.
California law heavily favors the prosecution, and if anyone remembers the CNN coverage of the verdicts in the Michael Jackson criminal case, attorney Robert Shapiro was predicting a conviction and talking about how under California law it was very hard to get an acquittal when this other evidence of other similar acts was allowed into the courtroom. So my feeling is we not only vindicated Michael on the Arvizo claims, we vindicated him on all these other allegations, Chandler, Franzia, Robson, Macaulay Culkin, Brett Barnes. I think we acquitted him on everything. That's how I view the acquittals that that Jordan played at the beginning of the show.
Yes, you did a great job, Mr. Mesereau, and I always... I understood that it was somebody else who was compared to Clarence Darrow, but I always say that you should be compared to Clarence Darrow.
Well, thank you very much. Clarence Darrow's one of my heroes.
I know.
I read books that he wrote. I read books about him, and I always will my whole life because he's one of my heroes and role models.
And is that the reason that you became an attorney? Because you...
It's one of the reasons. My father was a West Point graduate. He always wished he'd gone to law school. He took a law course at the military academy when he was there. And he always said to me, if you want to be a lawyer, it'd be great. If you're not sure what you want to do, consider law school because it'll give you a lot of options. And he was correct. And I'll always be grateful to him for guiding me that way.
And thank you for the call. Okay, I did want to play some of this audio. Let's take it. This is the news playing what the defense has in mind. Let's take a listen.
We begin right here. Attorney Tom Mesereau, he is wrapping up the defense's closing arguments in Michael Jackson's child molestation trial. MSNBC's Jennifer London is standing by for us live outside that courthouse in Santa Maria, California. As usual, at your post. Good afternoon to you, Jennifer.
Hi, Alex. Lead defense attorney Tom Mesereau continues his aggressive attack on the accuser and his family. This morning, he started off by focusing on the adult magazines the prosecution claims Jackson showed to the accuser in this case and other accusers as part of the grooming process. Tom Mesereau saying, well, where's the evidence? He says four other alleged victims testified during this trial, and they say Jackson never showed them any adult magazines. Mesereau went on to say the only two people who claim Jackson did, the accuser and his brother, who Mesereau says are con artists, actors, and liars. This is definitely becoming a theme during the defense's closing arguments. We have heard those three words used four times. Tom Mesereau also saying the prosecution's case is lacking a critical piece of evidence. It's called a pretext phone call. That is when the police have the accuser call the accused on the phone The police record it, and the police hope that the accused says something incriminating. Tom Mesro saying it wasn't done in this case because the accuser refused to call Jackson because the accuser knew Jackson would not say anything. Tom Mesro also using transcripts from this trial, testimony from the accuser, his brother, his mother, and his sister. Tom Mesro highlighting parts of those parts of the testimony, pointing out inconsistencies, referring to the accuser's testimony where at one point he said he was molested five times, and then another time he said he was molested two times. Tom Mesro says he, quote, flip-flops because he's a liar. And for the first time today, we did see a number of Michael Jackson's family members arrive at the courthouse. For the first time, we saw Janet Jackson. She was with her sister Latoya and Rebe, and we also saw three of Jackson's brothers. Alex, now back to you.
While the jury in the Michael Jackson case returns to court tomorrow after a month-long trial that has attracted worldwide attention, there is word tonight that Michael Jackson has entered the hospital again. More on the case from NBC's Mike Taibbi.
The trial's last day was a tense one. The crowd's on edge, and Michael Jackson and his family bracing for a last exchange of broadsides over a set of facts open to two totally opposite interpretations. If he shares his bed with boys, has drinking issues, and collects pornography, then these are sexual relationships, prosecutor Ron Zonin said. That is the only explanation.
As Mr. Zonin said, nobody wants to be a child molester. You act because you can't control yourself.
But, answered Jackson's lead attorney, Tom Mesro, listen to the boys, including actor Macaulay Culkin, who testified Jackson never gave them booze or porn and never once touched them inappropriately, as prosecutors charged. And look at the boy and the family in this case. Actors, con artists, and liars, he kept repeating. Mesro highlighted what he said were dozens of their lies, contradictions, and claims refuted by other witnesses. You must, he said, throw this case where it belongs, out the door.
Tom Mesro is on fire with passion, and he is resolved to make sure that Michael Jackson walks out of here a free man.
Jackson will be allowed to wait out the verdict at his Neverland Valley Ranch home, as long as he can get back to court within an hour of being notified that a decision has been reached. The jury was left with the two video images in conflict in this case. A boy, a cancer survivor, telling police how he claims Michael Jackson molested him, like so many boys before him, prosecutors said. And the pop star himself, poignantly explaining that children alone have never betrayed or deceived him, and how hurting a child, any child, would be impossible. Each image pressed on this jury with equivalent urgency.
Don't kid yourself. This is Michael Jackson's life that they hold in their hands.
A life they resume judging tomorrow morning. Mike Taibbi, NBC News, Santa Maria, California.
All right, Tom, what do you make of their interpretation of your closing argument?
Well, you're bringing back old memories of what a battle this whole thing was. Closing argument. When I began trying cases as a young lawyer, I thought closing argument was primarily designed to turn people around, to change their views, to make sure their views are yours. And as time went on, my view about the primary purpose of closing argument shifted a bit. I think by the time you get to closing argument, a lot of jurors have a good idea where they're going and where they intend to go in the jury room. I think what you're doing in closing argument primarily is giving the ammunition and the information to the jurors who are either on your side or in the middle so that they can argue, you know, your side in the jury room and during jury deliberations. So what I was trying to do was give any juror who might be open-minded to our side all the information they needed, all the lies, all the contradictions, all the exaggerations, all the problems with the prosecution witnesses and with their case. And those quotes you played bring back some old memories, I'll tell you. Hard to believe it's
yes,
10 years
indeed. All right, one thing I just got to ask you, what's your opinion of the judge throwing out the Wade Robson situation that he was molested 25 years ago or whatever it was?
Well, I'm sorry it took as long as it did, but at least it happened. I mean, I've said from day one that that case was absurd, that Robson was my first witness in the defense case in the Michael Jackson criminal trial. I called him as our first witness because he was one of the strongest witnesses I knew of, supporting Michael Jackson and disputing the prosecution's claims. And to suddenly, years later, after Michael's deceased and can't even speak for himself, to suddenly turn around and say, I've been molested, I think is absurd. I'm happy the judge threw it out. I think it's justice, and I hope the Court of Appeals agrees with the trial judge. But I'm surprised it took as long as it did to get dismissed.
Absolutely. A question from at SaneMJFan on Twitter. Sorry, Jordan won't be able to listen to your show, so can you ask Mr. Mesereau if he knows if Jimmy Safechuck really got married at Neverland? He asked prosecution witness, this is the writer saying, he asked prosecutor witness, I'm going to try to pronounce this as best as I can, Kiki Foreigner, if she remembered if Safechuck got married at Neverland in the 90s. If he really did get married in the 90s there, that would severely undermine his credibility regarding the current false claims against MJ that he's making alongside Wade Robson. Well, first of all, I'm just going to ask you, shouldn't the claims, since they were much longer for Safechuck, I believe they were almost a decade longer, the allegations against Michael, shouldn't they be thrown out because they're almost like coincide together?
Well, I think they should be thrown out. I think they should be thrown out. I predict they get thrown out. I think Safechuck just joined the Wade Robson bandwagon, and hopefully his fate will be similar. You know, both of them are just, their claims are ridiculous. They're absurd. They're untimely. They're, you know, way beyond when they should have been filed, and in my opinion, they're false. So I don't think Safechuck will fare much better than Robson. As far as his being married at Neverland, I frankly, you know, I vaguely remember my examination of Kiki Fournier, and I can't remember what I based that question on. Obviously, at the time, I certainly believed that happened at Neverland, but I don't remember the facts well enough now to really answer that question.
Oh, okay. Okay, here's probably our last clip for the Jennifer London and Jesse Jackson, and then I want to get your reaction.
We are well now into the third day of jury deliberations in the Michael Jackson trial, and although we don't know much about what is going inside the courthouse, there is some more activity outside the courthouse yet again today. MSNBC's Jennifer London is there standing by live in Santa Maria, California. Good afternoon, Jennifer.
Hi, and good afternoon, Natalie. There certainly is a growing sense of anticipation here in Santa Maria outside of the courthouse as we await any news that a verdict has been reached. Also, there are a growing number of fans gathering here today. This morning, it was actually quite, it was not a lot of fans, but today we are seeing more and more fans arrive here in the afternoon. And let's go ahead and show you a live look of the scene outside of the courthouse. You can see some of the fans. They have signs. They have banners. Sometimes they're playing Michael Jackson music. And really, no information coming from inside the courtroom. We do know the jury is hard at work. They have been deliberating since just before 8:30 a.m. Pacific time. And if these fans are hoping to get a glimpse of Michael Jackson arriving here at the courthouse today, we don't expect to see him unless a verdict is reached. But these fans were treated to the arrival of another Jackson. Reverend Jesse Jackson showed up here not too long ago. He's been described as a spiritual advisor to Michael Jackson. He says he does plan on meeting with Jackson later today at the pop star's Neverland home. And Reverend Jesse Jackson says he is here as a guest of the pop star. Remember, Michael Jackson is still under the gag order, which means he cannot comment on the case. But here is what Reverend Jackson had to say not too long ago.
Michael is fighting back with all of the fervor that we saw in his creativity, but as an artist. But what is amazing to me about it, he does so with a degree of positiveness that is in his talks. No bitterness, and no anger, and this abiding confidence in the judicial process.
And jury deliberations continue at this hour. As you can see from our jury deliberation clock that's on your screen right now, the jury has been hard at work for about 11 hours and 40 minutes, and that is another live look at the fans gathered outside here in Santa Maria. And Natalie, that is where we will be for the rest of the day, and we will certainly bring you any news as it becomes available.
Tom, your thoughts on Jennifer London reporting? Good job, bad job, fair job?
Well, I mean, she's just, I don't really know a lot of the other reporting she did, because remember, I was in the middle of this whole thing, and, you know, most of the 5 months that the trial took, I was preparing, not listening to media reports. You know, I would take a break once in a while, listen to a media report, and then after 10 or 20 minutes, I would go back to my preparation, and that's all I could do. So she's reporting during jury deliberation, which was a very, you know, tense period. As I recall, jury deliberations went for about 8 days. And, you know, it's speculating about what a jury's thinking or saying or doing is, you know, is to some extent ridiculous, because nobody really knows. You know, this was a wild period. All of us were on pins and needles, day by day, you know, hour by hour, minute by minute, you know, wondering, is there going to be a verdict? Who's running the jury room? Who's in control? Who's influential? You know, it's all speculation. You just don't know. And you just hope that justice will be done. And eventually justice was done. You know, 14 acquittals, full exoneration of Michael Jackson. And he walked out of there free and with his head held high and with his reputation preserved. But as I said before, I think his spirit was broken that he had to go through a thing like that. But as far as the reporting on the jury process goes, it's just pure guessing. It's just speculation. Nobody really knows.
Yes, I did find this last clip that I wanted to play. Michael talking to his friend and late manager, Frank DeLeo, after the verdict, and then we'll say goodnight.
And this love, what is it, 1108? That vindicates him from all of this stuff.
When were you his manager?
I managed him during 1984 to 89.
What
through
the
Thriller and Bad, the Victory Tour, and the Solo Tour.
What's he like?
He's one of the nicest, most talented human beings I've ever met. And he's a person that looks only for the good in people. That's why sometimes he gets into trouble. If he looked at both sides, he wouldn't catch himself in these situations. But he only looks for the good.
So what do you think happened here? I mean, this is, I mean, he faced going to prison for 20 years or more.
Yeah, but you see, he knew he wasn't guilty. We knew he wasn't guilty. That's why he showed up today. And he showed up every day.
You know, A lot of people thought he'd run.
I never thought he would run. I knew he would come and face the music.
Did there come a time though when you thought that, you know, that he, you know,
I would have ran myself. I'd have been out of there.
Well, that's what a lot of people said behind the scenes here, a lot of the media, you know, that different people would have run as well. Did you worry about the fact, I mean, the verdict can go another way?
I was worried when they called and said they had a verdict. I mean, that's when you really start to get nervous. But I knew he wasn't guilty, and I knew this family was a bunch of gypsies just passing through.
I mean, the accuser and the family.
Yes.
You sat there how many days, at least the last couple weeks I've seen you
there? I've been
there
about 3 weeks or so.
How hard has this been on his parents?
I think it's been very difficult. It's quite a strain to sit there, hear them say the bad things that they say about your son, and then when the media starts in, I mean, sometimes some of this media had no mercy.
We have 30
they
seconds.
Forgot he was a human being.
We have 30 seconds left. Can he resurrect his career?
He can resurrect his career. He's a very talented human being.
Talented. What does he have to do?
Right now he just has to worry about getting healthy and relax. Everything else will fall into place because he's vindicated.
Frank, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Tom, your thoughts on his dear friend Frank DeLeo and saying what he said following being acquitted by you?
Well, I got to know Frank DeLeo during the trial. He spent a lot of time with the family, with Michael, you know, showing his support. And I got to know him a little better after the trial. because I wasn't as preoccupied with what I was doing. And Frank was always a very nice guy to me, and a very loyal supporter of Michael Jackson, and always seemed very down-to-earth to me. I can only say nice things about Frank DeLeo. You know, anyone who was around Michael Jackson in any business capacity seems to have become controversial. Some people liked them,
right.
Some didn't. Sometimes they would have ups and downs with Michael Jackson, and people would have different reactions to that. But my memories of Frank are very good ones. I think he was a decent guy who really stood behind Michael during a dark hour, and I liked the things he said.
Okay, we have a question from the chat. Molor, Tom, did you or any other lawyer think of contacting Jimmy Zachoff during or before the trial? He claims that MJ wanted him to testify at the end of the trial. Is that true?
I don't. If Michael talked to him directly, I'm not aware of it. We never intended to call him in the defense case. I had never spoken to him, and I don't know really what he's talking about.
Okay, we have Rio Girl Shirley says, please thank Tom from my soul for his complete support for MJ. So that's in my chat room. So there you go.
Well, thank you very much.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yes, indeed. And, wow, can you believe it is exactly, as we sign off here, 10 years ago today, you were sitting outside a Santa Barbara courtroom in 14 counts of victory. I mean, how does it feel?
It feels very, very, very good. I was blessed to have been his lead criminal lawyer. I'm blessed to have known him. I'm blessed to have been called to defend him during his darkest hour. It was a high point of my career, and God was with us, and I feel very honored to have been in that position.
Well, Tom, I want to thank you for coming on this special short-notice show. You did a wonderful job, and you did a wonderful job at trial. Continue good luck on your career, and may God bless you.
Thank you very much, Jordan, and thank you for the honor and privilege of being on your show, and thank you for all the great work you do so that people remember who the true Michael Jackson was. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Tom. It's been a pleasure. Good evening. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that was the legendary Tom Mesereau, who acquitted Michael Jackson from A to Z. Don't you forget that. A wonderful humanitarian guy, and we will, you will definitely, if you want to hear this again, just wait 10 minutes and you will hear it. Should have the video done by Luna Joe in a week or so. But for now, thank you to everybody who listened in. Thank you to everybody who advertised. Here's some audio, courtesy of Luna Joe, of what Michael Jackson was going through on verdict day. Take a listen as 2 days talking about what possibly Michael went through. And these are, one of them is Michael's closest friend. So a few minutes, enjoy it, very interesting, and then we'll wish you a good night.
I mean, going on the Martin Bashir documentary Living with Michael Jackson years ago and saying it's okay to share your bed with a child. I mean, don't you think in some senses most people are going to say, well, he kind of set himself up for that?
Well, let me explain to you what was said to me. Michael and I spoke about that. And he said, Corey, when I was a kid, I was denied not only a childhood, but I was denied love. When I reached out to hug my father, he didn't hug me back. When I was scared on an airplane, he didn't put his arm around me and say, Michael, don't worry, it's going to be okay. When I was scared to go on stage, he said, get your ass on that stage.
Good morning. At 12:05 today, Michael Jackson was taken into custody at the Santa Barbara Airport.
So he said to me, Corey, I will never deny a child love. And if it means that I have to be crucified or put in jail for it, then that's just what they're going to have to do. And so when it was time for him to stand trial, the first time he went through it and his advisors told him, Michael, this is not good. Pay this kid off. Second time he said, you know what? All that did was make me look guilty, like I was hiding something. So this time, there won't be any payoffs. I'm going to fight this in court, and you'll see. I'll be innocent.
His back is in terrible pain. He was in terrible discomfort during the entire trial proceedings. He's going to go home, recuperate, rest and relax, and he'll be back on Monday, and he's looking forward to being here. And he went to the emergency room this morning, and he was given medications. So he'll be back on Monday, and we all thank you so very much. You take care.
Sorry. I can't speak now.
Sorry. Okay. Are you hurting right now, Michael?
Yeah. Here, Michael.
Until the day, down, right to the day when they finally had to read the verdict, and the verdict was in. I talked to his family, and they were, you know, because I remember watching on the news, they had like 45 minutes to get there. And so I spoke to some of his family members who were in the house with Michael. And they, I said, well, what the hell is he doing? They say, well, he's upstairs getting dressed. He came downstairs. He said a prayer with his family, and he told everyone, he said, I want you guys not to worry about me because I will be okay. And he rode there. He had maybe a little nervous energy, patting his feet, singing in the car and everything. And he rode with his brother and his sister. But he wasn't worried. I'm going to tell you something. I would have been a mess. When Michael was on trial, nobody stopped to go and support him at the trial. You know, the guy is acquitted on 10 counts of child molestation or whatever. No one said, sorry, Michael. No one said, Michael, we knew you were innocent. No one did a BET tribute to him then. How come all the artists didn't band together back then and say, hey, you know what? Let's do a tour like Michael did when he did the We Are the World tour, and let's raise some money. Let's get this thing going. I don't know if you remember when there was a guy named Tukey Williams on trial in California.
Name sounds familiar.
Tukey Williams is the founder of the Crips gang.
Yeah.
You know the Crips and the Bloods?
Yeah.
Okay, and they were trying to get him, get him pardoned from the death penalty.
Yeah.
And half of Hollywood showed up for this man. And what I can't understand is, like, okay, people didn't want to go near Michael Jackson when he was in trouble.
But they show up for a murderer.
But they show up for a guy who executed families a little girl begged for her life, and he executed her. And they said because he wrote, in his time in prison, he wrote children's books that he tried to turn his life around. You know, he was nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize. Well, how about the millions of children that Michael Jackson has helped over his career, span of his career? Yet two children come with some false allegations, and those two children become the two children that destroy him. It's crazy. So it makes me look at the entertainment business and just say, I mean, I'm surrounded by a bunch of hypocrites.
Superior Court of the State of California for the County of Santa Barbara, Santa Maria Division. The people of the State of California, plaintiff versus Michael Joe Jackson, defendant. Case number 1133603. Count 1, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of conspiracy as charged in count 1 of the indictment. Dated June 13, 2005. Four person number 80. Count 2, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count 2 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 3, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count 3 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 4, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count 4 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80. Count 5, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count 5 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80. Count 6, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of attempting to commit a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count 6 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 7, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of administering an intoxicating agent to assist in the commission of a felony as charged in count 7 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 7, verdict, lesser offense. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of providing alcoholic beverages to persons under the age of 21, a lesser included offense of that charge in count 7 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 8, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of administering an intoxicating agent to assist in the commission of a felony as charged in count 8 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 8, verdict, lesser offense. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of providing alcoholic beverages to persons under the age of 21, a lesser included offense that charged in count 8 of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count 9, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of administering an intoxicating agent to assist in the commission of a felony as charged in count 9 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80. Count 9, verdict, lesser offense. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of providing alcoholic beverages to persons under the age of 21, a lesser included offense of that charge in count 9 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80. Count 10, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of administering an intoxicating agent to assist in the commission of a felony as charged in count 10 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80. Count 10 verdict, lesser offense. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of providing alcoholic beverages to persons under the age of 21, a lesser included offense of that charge in count 10 of the indictment, dated June 10, 2005, for person number 80.
That completes the reading of the verdicts. I am now going to go off the air.
The end of the audio from inside the courtroom of Judge Rodney Melville. Michael Jackson has been acquitted on all counts. He will walk from the courtroom. Michael Jackson is a free man tonight. He was acquitted today of all charges, pronounced not guilty on the seventh day of jury deliberations. His lawyers tried very hard to paint a portrait of an innocent modern-day Peter Pan, a childlike 46-year-old man who simply loves children. In the end, the jury decided the evidence of child molestation and other charges was not enough, and in siding with Jackson's defense, they handed prosecutors a big loss in a very public case. Our coverage begins tonight with NBC's Mike Taibbi. Mike, good evening.
Evening, Brian. For more than a dozen years, there have been rumors fueled by a tabloid frenzy and obsession with Michael Jackson. Two payoffs to earlier accusers that amounted to millions of dollars. And finally, starting in January, a trial in this case that lasted for scores of witnesses and finally came to a conclusion with that series of not guilties, 10 in all, at the end of the second week in June.
When a British documentary in February 2003 repeated old rumors about Jackson, it also wrung this admission from him.
The most loving thing to do is to share your bed with someone.
That the pop star shared his bedroom with children, innocently, he said, including boys like this young cancer survivor. But that was enough to trigger a criminal investigation by a district attorney who had pursued Jackson for a decade.
Get over here and get checked in.
It took almost a year, but Jackson was arrested. The core of a 10-count indictment, the charge that on at least four occasions at his Neverland Ranch, he had given alcohol to that cancer patient and then molested him. It was a difficult case. The boy and his siblings and mother all proved to be such credibility challenge witnesses in the trial that most experts thought their testimony alone would not have led to a conviction.
Unless there's physical evidence, if this jury doesn't believe this boy, then there's no case.
But California is one of only a handful of states that in sex crimes trials allows testimony about old, unproven allegations. Three of Jackson's alleged victims, notably the actor Macaulay Culkin, came to court to emphatically deny any inappropriate behavior by Jackson ever. But the cumulative effect of all that so-called propensity evidence, including Jackson's settlements with two earlier accusers, was undeniably powerful. Critically important, powerful, but not enough to persuade this jury that the burden of proof beyond a reasonable doubt had been met.
And it seemed as though he's lying. And the jury, the foreman of the jury, believed that this child was lying. And the whole jury ultimately agreed that the child was lying. This boy studied acting, and it just doesn't seem real.
This case, that's what bugged me. They were getting him for his lifestyle and not for whether he was guilty of the crime. That's why I knew he was going to be acquitted.
Well,
I was convinced all along the jury would find him not guilty. I thought the prosecution's case was really ridiculous, and I thought they went to every absurd length they could to try and make something out of nothing. So I was not surprised by the verdict.
What's good, fellas? Let's go, man. Let's do this.